That we know it. All right, welcome to worship, everybody. So exciting. We have a few new faces with us tonight, which is great to see you all. Welcome to those who are online worshiping with us today. Thank you so much for being with us and celebrating. Isn't that odd to say? We talked about it last Sunday. Celebrating Holy Week. Couple of announcements for everybody. We are going to have mobile communion on Sunday from 12:30 to 2:30. So anyone who's worshiping online and who would want Holy Communion, we'll bless it during church. And then you can go ahead and drive up between 12:30 and 2:30 out front, and we can have Holy Communion. Also, part of our liturgical art for Pentecost, which is the end of May, is going to be origami. I call them doves, but they're technically cranes. So anyone who wants to help us, because we're going to need, you know, lots. So anyone who wants to help us make some origami cranes, there's a origami paper out in the narthex. And then we'll also have a workshop, a hands-on workshop, Thursday, April 8th at 6:30 in the Claire Wolf Lounge or online. To teach us how to do those cranes, and then we'll decide if we want to keep meeting together and online, just, you know, because we miss each other. It'll be fun, and we'll make a ton of cranes. I've been doing it for the last couple of months, and I'm telling you guys, it is like meditation. It is so wonderful for self-care. I think I've made way too many. I'll give them as gifts. And lastly, the Child Development Center is hiring 2-year-old teachers, preschool or pre-K teachers, and also are looking for staff for the summertime. So we have full and part-time positions available. Anyone who's graduated from high school, go ahead and come on in and apply. So this is a great place to work, and the CDC is looking to expand their team. So just give us a call and let us know if you are interested. And if you're not interested, share it with someone else who might be. All right. Are there any other announcements today? Well, let's calm our hearts and minds and prepare ourselves to worship with a moment of silence. We are invited to sit or kneel for the confession and forgiveness. Merciful God, Jesus revealed the great depth of your love in his determination to defeat evil, even when this meant giving up his own life. Forgive us, O God, when we allow the power of evil to flourish, because we fear that taking up one's cross would be just too costly an exercise. Gracious God, forgive our lack of trust in you. Have mercy on us and forgive us. Forgive our excesses when we consume more than our share while others go with basic needs unmet. Have mercy on us and forgive us. Forgive us when we fail to reach out in care and concern for others because we are too busy or too unaware. Have mercy on us and forgive us. Help us when we hesitate and strengthen us when we are weak. Breathe your spirit into our lives and give us the courage to follow Jesus wherever he leads us. We are invited to silently confess our sins to God. We are invited to stand for the assurance of forgiveness. People of God, hear this good news. God's covenant with us is true. God is faithful even when we fail. Through the Holy Spirit, God gives us the gift of faith and makes us righteous. Believe in the good news that your sins are forgiven and you are set free to live as children of God. Amen. Thanks be to God. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Please join me in our gathering prayer. Gracious God, we gather to recall the night when Jesus was betrayed. In this sacred and solemn week, we see again the depth and mystery of your redeeming love. We pledge to follow where you go, to stop where you stop, to listen when you cry, to hurt as you suffer, and to bow our heads in sorrow when you die. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We are invited to be seated for our gathering hymn.
Let us now hear the word of God through our holy scriptures. Our reading today is from the 12th chapter of Exodus. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month shall mark for you the beginning of months. It shall be the first of the year for you. Tell the whole congregation of Israel that on the 10th of this month they are to take a lamb for each family, a lamb for each household. If a household is too small for a whole lamb, it shall join its closest neighbor in obtaining one. The lamb shall be divided in proportion to the number of people who eat it. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a year old male. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats. You shall keep it until the 14th day of this month. Then the whole assembled congregation of Israel shall slaughter it at twilight. They shall take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and the lintel of the houses in which they eat it. They shall eat the lamb that same night. They shall eat it, roasted over a fire with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. Do not eat of any of it raw or boiled in water, but roasted over a fire with its head, legs, and inner organs. You shall not let any of it remain until the morning. Anything that remains until morning you shall burn. This is how you shall eat it: your loins girded, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. And you shall eat it hurriedly. It is the Passover of the Lord, for I will pass through the land of Egypt that night, and I will strike down every firstborn in the land of Egypt, both human beings and animals. On all of the gods of Egypt I will execute judgments. I am the Lord. The blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you live. When I see the blood, I will pass over you, and no plague shall destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. This day shall be a day of remembrance for you shall celebrate it as a festival to the Lord. Throughout your generations, you shall observe it as a perpetual ordinance." The word of the Lord.
We are invited to stand for our Holy Gospel reading. The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 13th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Now before the festival of Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, He loved them to the end. The devil had already put it into the heart of Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray him. And during supper, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God, got up from the table, took off his outer robe, and tied a towel around himself. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was tied around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered, "You do not know now what I am doing, but later you will understand." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no share with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head." Jesus said to him, "One who has bathed does not need to wash except for the feet, but is entirely clean. You are clean, though not all of you." For he knew who was to betray him. For this reason, he said, "Not all of you are clean." After he had washed their feet and put on his robe and returned to the table, he said to them, "Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example that you also should do as I have done to you. Very truly I tell you, servants are not greater than their masters, nor are messengers greater than the one who sent them. If you know these things, you are blessed if you do them." Jesus said, "Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself and will glorify him at once. Little children, I am with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and as I said to the Jews, so now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love for one another." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. So ritual is so important to our faith. A ritual is an activity that we do that reminds us of an important story of our faith. And that story is important because it teaches us who we are as a people of God, as a people of Jesus Christ. So we create ritual around these really important stories. But let me be really clear. Holy Communion and Holy Baptism are not rituals. They're sacraments. The difference is a sacrament is commanded by God that we have to do it, and it is done by God. God commands us to participate in Holy Communion, and Jesus Christ is the host. God calls us to be baptized, and the Holy Spirit does the baptism. Now, a ritual is done by us, and it is, again, to remind us of the stories of the Bible that teach us who we are in God, who we are in Jesus Christ. And one of those very important stories to Jesus and to all of the Jewish community is Passover. It's what we read today Kelly Zimmerman read today from the Hebrew Scriptures. It's the story of Passover. And our Jewish brothers and sisters have created a ritual called a Seder meal that they do on the first night of Passover. And this Seder meal is a ritual that's done to teach, to remember the story, to teach about it, and to help the Jewish people and us as Christians, because we share in that story, it helps us to remember the important story of the Exodus of the Israelite people from slavery in Egypt to freedom. God delivered the Israelite people. God delivered us from slavery to freedom. And this is such an important story that our Jewish brothers and sisters created this Seder meal to help us remember that holy story, and that we are the holy people of God, delivered by God from slavery to freedom. Well, remember, Jesus was Jewish. And so Jesus, too, celebrated this major festival season of Passover. So some Christian theologians wonder if the meal that Jesus and the disciples shared this holy night, the Last Supper, was actually a Seder meal. So in this Seder, each food that they eat has an important purpose to help them remember, to help them in the ritual. So I want to take a minute today and watch a video about the Seder plate.
Seder means order and is also the name of the ritual meal eaten during the Jewish holiday Passover. Passover celebrates the Jewish people's escape from slavery in Egypt, as told in Exodus. The Seder plate is the meal's centerpiece, and each item holds symbolic meaning. Zeruah. The shank bone represents the lamb sacrificed at the Temple of Jerusalem during celebration. Beitzah. An egg also represents the Passover sacrifice, as well as the cycle of life. Charoset. This paste, made of apples, nuts, and wine, resembles the bricks and mortar the Jewish slaves were forced to make. Maror. A bitter herb, usually horseradish, represents the bitterness of slavery in Egypt. Karpas. A leafy vegetable is dipped in salt water to represent the tears of the Jewish people. Chazeret. Another bitter herb, eaten with charoset and matzah. Now that the Seder plate is in order, get ready for the rest of the feast. Happy holiday, or Chag Sameach.
So this is a ritual that our Jewish brothers and sisters do to remind them of how God delivered them from slavery into freedom. Now, doesn't that sound familiar to our own story of Jesus Christ? That Jesus Christ delivers us from slavery to sin, and now we have freedom in new life? So God has promised us from antiquity, from our history. We see at Passover, God delivered the Israelite people from slavery to freedom. And we see through Christ's crucifixion that God continues to deliver us from slavery to sin to freedom in Jesus Christ. And one of the rituals that we do in a story that is so central to who we are as Christ followers is on this holy night. Just like our Jewish brothers and sisters have Passover has Seder to remember their Passover, we have foot washing to remember Jesus Christ on this holy night and the story of how he washed the feet of the disciples. But unfortunately, we aren't able to wash each other's feet on this night because of the pandemic. And some of us might actually be relieved, because let's be honest, washing people's feet is really uncomfortable. In Jesus' time, it wasn't so weird because they all wore sandals and they walked everywhere, unless they were blessed enough to have a horse or a donkey. They walked everywhere. So they walked miles and miles. And they come into someone's home and they do what every good guest does. They take off their shoes. The problem is their feet are nasty. Their feet are full of dirt and sweat and gross. And then they take a step onto their host's carpet and rugs. And their host is thinking, that's going to take some washing. So what they would do is have servants come. And the servants would wash their feet so they could walk over the host's house and they don't have to worry about getting it gross. Well, nowadays, we wear socks. Hopefully not with our sandals, but some of us do. But we wear socks. Or when we walk around in sandals, we walk around on cement. We're very rarely walking around on dirt roads like they did in Jesus' time. So our feet aren't nasty when we go to someone's house. So we don't do feet washing. So in Jesus' time, it wasn't so weird because servants washed feet all the time. But today, I don't know about you guys, but before Monday, Thursday, I usually give myself a pedicure. Yeah, I know. Because I want my toes to look good for whoever's going to wash my feet. But when we think about ritual, we want to remember this holy story. This happens the night before Jesus is betrayed. I mean, this is important. And so we need to remember this story, so we create a ritual about it. And we do foot washing, just like Jesus. And we do that to remind ourselves who we are in Jesus Christ. And who we are in Jesus Christ are servants. Jesus says there is no master, there is no servant, there is no messenger, there is no sender. We're all the same. Masters wash servants' feet. Servants wash masters' feet. Servants let masters wash their feet. Sometimes that's the hardest part. Is letting someone else wash our feet. It's a lot easier to wash someone else's. So sometimes the grace, the gift, is in allowing someone to serve us. So what we learn from this holy story is through Jesus Christ, as a people of Jesus, as followers of Jesus, we are called to be servants, to serve others, and also to grace others. To love others by letting them serve us. So what ritual can we do tonight when we can't wash each other's feet? Well, I did my best, and each one of you, and those of you who are at home, I invite you to go and grab some lotion. People here have each been given a small container of baby, all natural, no scent, no nothing. Lotion, just in case we have allergies. And what we're going to ask tonight is that God anoint our hands. Just as Jesus Christ washed the feet of his servant, of his disciples, so that they could go and be servants, we're going to ask Jesus Christ again tonight to anoint and bless our hands so that we can go out into the world and serve others. And remember to let others serve us as well. So I invite you all to grab your lotion. As we do our Monday, Thursday ritual of anointing in service to others by anointing our hands. On this night, we have heard our Lord's commandment to love one another as he has loved us. We who receive God's love in Jesus Christ are called to love one another, to be servants to each other as Jesus became our servant through his death on the cross. Our commitment to this loving service is signified in the washing of feet, following the example of our Lord, which he gave to us on this night before his death. However, we cannot do a foot washing this year due to the pandemic. So instead, we are going to anoint our hands in the name of Jesus Christ so our hands can be instruments of God's love. So please join me in the prayer that you can find on the screen. Holy God, we ask you to bless our hands tonight in service toward you and in service to one another. Guide our hands by your Holy Spirit to bring help to those in need, healing to those who are hurt, and safe embraces to those who need comfort. Amen. As Will sings, we are invited to take lotion and anoint our hands in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Invited to stand for Holy Communion. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed our duty and our joy that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to God, who calls us as followers of Jesus Christ to love and serve one another. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise God's name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We are invited to take our communion and remove that top cellophane layer, and you'll see the white piece of bread. Go ahead and take that out. On the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took the bread, blessed it, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." We are invited as a community of Jesus Christ to eat the bread. Again, after supper, he took the cup, blessed it, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." We are invited to drink the cup. Lord, remember us in your love and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Lord Jesus, in a wonderful sacrament, you strengthen us with the saving power of your suffering, death, and resurrection. May this sacrament of your body and blood so work in us that the fruits of your redemption will show forth in the way we live. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We are invited to be seated. After sharing the Last Supper with the disciples, the end of Jesus' life begins to come quickly. In less than 24 hours, Jesus will pray in Gethsemane before his betrayal by Judas and arrest. During his trial, he will be mocked, beaten, spat upon, and be crowned with thorns. He will be burdened with the cross and walk with it to Golgotha, where he will be crucified and will die. As his life was stripped from him, so we strip our altar of signs of life. This symbolizes the suffering and death of Jesus. I invite Andrew and Will up now to help me with the stripping of the altar. As we leave this space in silence, we remember the death of Jesus Christ coming soon. Amen.